Welcome to this tutorial on Adobe Acrobat 11 Pro. This program allows you to create, view, and edit files in Portable Document Format, or PDF for short, which is readable on any computer workstation. Because of this, people use it mainly to convert documents created in other software programs, such as Microsoft Word or PowerPoint. It keeps the look and layout of the source program intact, like an electronic snapshot. If you want to share a Microsoft Word document, for instance, with someone who doesn't own the program, Adobe offers the free Adobe Reader 11 software, which that person can download and use to view your file in PDF format. In this tutorial, you will learn how to create a PDF file from an existing electronic document and from a web page. You'll learn how to combine multiple electronic files into a single PDF document. You'll see how to incorporate video into your PDF file. And you'll learn how to convert a form created in another program into a fillable PDF form. When you open Adobe Acrobat, the program displays its Getting Started window, which you see here. In the Getting Started menu, you can open an existing PDF file or create a new one. It doesn't matter what type of file you choose when creating a PDF. It could be a Word document, PowerPoint presentation, website, image, and so on. To create a PDF file from an existing electronic document, click on Create PDF under Select a Task. In the Open menu, find your file and double-click on it to open it. Adobe automatically converts the file to PDF format. The process may take a minute or so if it's a long document. Adobe Acrobat opens to display the following: the menu bar up top, toolbars below, the navigation pane on the left, and the document window. The menu bar provides access to all program functions. The toolbars offer quick access to some of the more popular menu choices, such as print or save. The document window displays the contents of your PDF, while the navigation pane displays thumbnails of the document pages, allowing easy browsing through the file. Let's take a closer look at the toolbars. Acrobat's default toolbar groupings provide one or two-click access to menu options, such as creating a new PDF, saving or printing a file, and zooming in and out. The Tools pane links you quickly to a host of functions, including basic text editing. The Create button allows you to create a PDF from an electronic or a scanned document. It also allows you to create a PDF portfolio. The File Commands group contains the Open, Save, and Print documents options. Quick Tools provide one-click access to common functions in Acrobat. Quick Tools is customizable. Page navigation contains the previous page, next page, and page number display. Select contains the Select button and also the Hand button. Zoom contains the Zoom Out and Zoom In icons, plus the Zoom Value display. Page display contains the scrolling mode, which is currently seen here, and single page, which shows the entire page. Customize lets you customize the tools that appear on the toolbar. Read mode allows you to view your document without the clutter of toolbars or task panes. To return to the normal screen, simply press Escape. The Tools pane provides access to numerous functions in Acrobat. Sign allows you to sign digitally your document. The comment pane to the right allows you to add comments to a PDF file. Let's look at the navigation pane buttons. These buttons on the left side of the document window each open a different panel in the navigation pane. Page thumbnails at the top displays a thumbnail view of all the pages in the open PDF file, making it easy to navigate through a lengthy document. Bookmarks enables you to jump to a specific section or page that's been previously bookmarked. Attachments allow you to attach files to your PDF document. The signatures option. A digital signature verifies your identity and may include a photo or an image of your handwritten signature. The options menu up top gives you various options for manipulating the pages in your document. For instance, adding, deleting, cropping, or rotating pages. Let's explore a little more about creating PDF files. If no file is currently open, you see the Getting Started window and can create a PDF there. But if a file is currently open, you can either choose File from the menu bar and then click on Create, or you can select the Create button from the top row of toolbar buttons to create a PDF file. You can also create a PDF from within Microsoft Office 2010 if it's set up to do that. If you're creating a file in Microsoft Word, PowerPoint, or Excel version 2010, you may see an Acrobat tab on the program's ribbon at the top of the screen. If you click on it, a PDF toolbar appears that enables you to convert your file without first having to launch Adobe Acrobat. Simply click on the Create PDF icon and the dialog box will pop up asking you to save your document. Navigate to the directory that will house the document and type the file name you want to use and then press Save. The file will open up in Adobe Acrobat. A note about naming PDF files. Whenever you save a file in PDF format, you should eliminate any spaces between the words in the file name. A common solution is to insert underscores in place of spaces. Instead of Intro to Adobe Acrobat 11 Pro with spaces between each word, I've chosen to place an underscore between each. Why this practice? Well, spaces in a file name are replaced by the ASCII coding equivalent, which is %0, whenever published to the web, and that makes the file name very difficult to read. Intro %202, %20, and so on. I'll close this file now and show you how to combine multiple files into a single PDF document. There are two different methods for combining files in Adobe Acrobat. The first is the Create PDF Portfolio method, and the second is the Combine Files into a Single PDF method. This tutorial will discuss the latter method. So under Getting Started, I'm going to click on Combine Files into PDF. And then I'm going to click on Add Files. A dialog box appears, and I'm going to go to the folder where my files are located, and I'm going to click on them. And because I want several, I can hold down my control key and click to select multiple files to open at once. I'll then click Open. My files are now displayed in the Combine Files window. If I want to change the position of a file in the list, I simply click on the file and drag it to the desired position. To remove a file from the list, I would highlight that file and I would press Delete on the keyboard, but I won't be doing that today. You can also click on the Zoom button on each file thumbnail to see better the contents of each file. And then click on the X to restore thumbnail view. When you're ready, click the Combine Files button. Acrobat combines and, where necessary, converts the files into a single PDF file, and the consolidated document is named Binder 1 by default. I'm going to click on the Thumbnails button so that you can see all the pictures in the navigation pane. I'd like to rename this file, so I'll go to File on the menu bar, and I'll choose Save As. In the Save As dialog box, I'll rename the newly combined PDF document. Oh, and I'm going to add an underscore. And then I'll press Save. There you go. I'll go ahead and close this file. Should I want to reopen it, I have a couple of options. If it's a recent file, I can click on it here, or I can go to File and choose Open and find the file and double-click on it. Now let's say I want to reorder pages within the document. There's a quick and easy drag-and-drop method, and I'm going to have to click on the Thumbnails view on the left. What I can do is to click on a page and then hold down the mouse and drag and let go where I'd like it to reappear. And then I'm going to go ahead and resave. And then I'll close this file. Next, I'll show you how to convert web pages into PDF files. Adobe Acrobat allows you to capture or convert selected content on a web page, or the entire website, or several layers of a multi-page website. Once Acrobat has converted the web pages into PDF format, they can be saved, printed, or emailed to others. I'll click on the Create button and choose Create PDF from web page. And I'm going to paste in the URL for the Himmelfarb Library website. Before I create my web page PDF, I'm going to click on the right facing arrow by Capture Multiple Levels. As a rule, I recommend only capturing one level. If you click Get Entire Site, it will take a very long time to download. So I'll go ahead and click Create, and it will take some time for it to convert. When done, the web page opens as a PDF file and is assigned a file name based on the web page's name, as you see here. What if I'd like to download or convert linked pages in this website? You'll notice links to unconverted pages are represented by the pointer changing to a pointing finger and displaying the unconverted URL. To convert and download the page, right mouse click on the link and you will see a drop-down menu. From the drop-down menu, choose Append to Document. This will download and convert the page, enabling the link to work. It also places a bookmark in the bookmark panel. I can use the bookmark panel to navigate or the scroll bar. I'm going to go ahead and close out this file and I'll say yes to accept the changes. And I'll save it in Documents. I'm now going to reopen the Introduction to Adobe Acrobat PDF file that I converted. And if I click on Bookmarks, you'll see all of the different sections of this document are already assigned bookmarks. That's because it recognizes my table of contents from Microsoft Word and simply transferred over the table of contents and made them bookmarks. So I can go through the file just like I do in the table of contents in Microsoft Word. While many authoring programs create bookmarks automatically that link you to different sections within the document, you can also create your own. Let's say I want to go to this bookmark about creating forms from an existing document, but I'd like to create a bookmark here where the note is. I simply click where I'd like to insert it, and I go to the new bookmark icon, and I'll add my title for the bookmark. Press Enter. And then if I'm somewhere else in the document and I want to go to that section, I simply click on it and it takes me there. If you'd like to add comments to a document, simply click on the Add Sticky Note button located on the Quick Tools section of the toolbar. Position your mouse where you'd like to insert the sticky note and then click once. A sticky note icon is added to the document and a window appears where you can enter comments. If that window does not appear, simply click inside the note icon. Type a short comment about the document. When finished, click the Minimize button in the upper right corner of the pop-up note, or just click outside the pop-up note. To view the contents of a sticky note, click once on the sticky note icon. The content of the sticky note reappears. If you want to delete a sticky note, you simply click once on the icon and press Delete. This version of Adobe Acrobat allows you to edit original text inside of the Acrobat program. To do so, you'll want to click on Edit Text and Images, the button that's on the Quick Tools toolbar, and then position the cursor by the text you wish to edit, and click once. And when you're done, you can click on the selection tool and your edit is accepted. Adobe Acrobat can incorporate multimedia into PDF documents, video, audio, etc. For the purpose of this tutorial, we will review how to add video into a PDF document. First, go to the section of your document where you would like to insert the video. Then go over to Tools. If the Tools menu is not open, click once on it to open. Go to Interactive Objects and then select Add Video. You'll notice that the cursor changes to a crosshair symbol. Draw a box where you would like to add your video. The Insert Video dialog box appears. Click the Browse button and select the media file that you want. The kinds of files you can include are Flash, MP4, and QuickTime. I'm going to go ahead and click OK. The video screen appears in my document, and I'm going to go ahead and click on the play button.
I'm here with Thomas Booker, founder, president, and CEO of Aquo Energy Drink.
Notice when I hover my mouse over the video screen that playback controls appear and allow me to control the video. I'm going to go ahead and save this. And now I'm going to close the file. Let's look at how to create fillable forms in Adobe Acrobat. You can create a form from an existing electronic document, such as a Word or an Excel file, or you can scan and convert a copy of a form and then add interactive form fields to it. For this tutorial, I'll show you how to create a form from an existing electronic document, in this case a Word file. In the Getting Started menu, I'm going to choose Create Form, and I'm going to select from an existing document. After I click Next, I'll click on the Browse button, go to Documents, and I'll pull up Journal Request Form. And then I will press Continue, and it'll take a moment to convert the file. A message appears on screen telling us we're in Form Editing View. This view lets us create and modify form fields. I'm going to click OK to eliminate the message. What you'll find out in many cases is that Acrobat is often not entirely successful in recognizing what you've intended to be form fields. Some fields go undetected upon conversion, and some areas of the file are mistakenly recognized as fields when in fact they are not. The cleanup work you must do to eliminate incorrectly added form fields and to create manually the form fields that the program failed to detect can be tedious. You might save time by redesigning your original document, if that is feasible, so that the fields are easier for Acrobat to recognize. Let's see what errors we can detect in this conversion. To make it easier, I'm going to pull up the original Word file. Notice these headers here? Acrobat has added form fields, so we need to delete those. To delete a field, simply click inside it once and press Delete. I'll do that again here. Everything else looks good. Just to be sure everything is in order, I'd like to close form editing and actually try entering information. To close form editing, go up here in the upper right corner and click on this button. As I enter text, I notice it's a little large. I'd like to reduce the font size a couple of points. To do this, I'll need to go back into Edit. So here, under Tools, I make sure Forms is displaying, and I'll select Edit. And then I'll right mouse click inside this field. I'll go to Properties. And I'll select Appearance. Font size is set to auto. I'd like to change that to 8 points and then press close. That changes it for this particular field, but if I do it here in the next field, you'll notice it says auto, as do all the remaining fields. Rather than change the point size field by field, I'd like to highlight all of the fields and make them 8 point. The easiest way to do that is for me to set the view to full page showing on the screen, and then I'll position my mouse a little outside the boxes, click and draw a box to highlight all the fields, and then in any of those fields I choose, I'll right mouse click and select Properties. Font size says varies because I did set it for 8 here, and then for the rest it's set to auto. I'm going to change this to 8 point, and now all my fields assume the same point size. To test this out, I'll close the editing screen and I will resize my window so I can see things a little better. That's more like it. Before I save this file, I'd like to clear out the information that I've entered. And the easiest way to do that is to go to More Form Options and select Clear Form. That way I can save it and post it online or email it to people. Now I'll go to File and Save, and I'll close out this form. I'm going to create another form from a Word document. So I'll go to Create Form, select From Existing Document, and Next, and then I'll click Browse and double click on the file. Continue. Again, we see the message that we're in form editing mode. I'll click OK to dismiss that message. I've chosen to convert this file because Adobe has had a particularly hard time distinguishing what is supposed to be a form field and what is not. So I have form fields where they don't belong, and I'm missing form fields where they should be. So let's start up at the top, and I have here a form field that I don't need, and for comparison I'm going to look at the Word document. This is just empty space here in Acrobat. It's listed as a form, so I'm going to delete it. Further down, I have another such form field. Again, it's empty space in the original document, so I'm going to delete that as well. Click inside and press Delete. Further down, I notice that I have some form fields, but they're not exactly displaying the way I would like them to. In the original document, this should all be spaced to enter text. And in Acrobat, I'm given this much space, so I'm going to click on the handles that surround the form box, shrink it down, and stretch it to the left. Next door, where it says type of position, I have a form field here that doesn't belong, and I'm missing form fields right here where I'm supposed to have selection boxes. I'll get back to that in a minute. Here is another form field that doesn't belong. And again, I'm going to need to add some selection boxes here. And this also is extraneous. And down below, in these sections, in the original document, the person should have all this space to write in. In Acrobat, they're given this much space. So again, I'm going to relocate this and click on the corner handle to stretch the box out so that there's much more room to type. And I'll do the same thing for these two form fields. Now I want to go and address the parts of my form that are missing fields. Up here in starting salary, I should have a field here and here. So I'm going to need to add manually a form field. Over here, under forms and tasks, I'll go to add new field. And notice the different kinds of fields I can select. Checkbox, radio button, drop-down menu, and so on. For this, it's simply a text field, so I'll click on that, and then I have guides to help me position my field as I click and drag to draw it. And then I'm able to type in a name for this field, and I'd like it to correspond to the word hourly. So I'll type that in, and then I'll click outside the box to get rid of it, and I'll do the same for annually, and I'll try to align them so that they are top aligned. I'll name this annually. And then click outside the yellow box. I'll do the same over here. Hourly. And annually. Moving down, I'm going to need to add form fields in these sections. So I'll go to add new field, and I have two choices. It isn't a text field, I'm merely creating a checkbox. So I could use checkbox or radio button. Let me start off with checkbox and see if that works for me. I'll position it here. And just click to insert it. And again, I'm going to give it a name corresponding to the text next to it. So this will be full time. I'll do the same, click checkbox, and put it here, and label it part time. And finally, here and type temporary. At this point, I would like to exit form editing and see if this is working for me so far. I'm going to go to the upper right corner and select Close Form Editing. And notice what happens if I click on each of them. I'm able to select more than one, and I really want this to be an either-or selection process, so the checkbox doesn't really work for me. I'm going to go to More Form Options and Clear Form, and I'm going to have to go back in and edit these. So I'm going to select Edit under Forms, and I'm going to need to delete these. So I'm going to click and draw a box around the three of these, and press delete. I'll start again, going to add new field, but this time I'm going to choose radio button. Again, I'll position my box where I want. And this time, I get a group name as well as radio button choice. Radio button choice is simply the field name, so I'm going to put full time. The group name refers to the section, so I'm going to change group 9 to type of position. And notice the message below. There's one button in the group, at least two buttons are needed, so I'm going to need to click on add another button. And again, I'm going to click, and I'll call this part-time. It's part of this group, and I'll add yet one more button. Try to align it. And I'll add temporary. The reason you need at least two radio buttons is that with radio buttons, you're making one selection from among a group of at least two radio buttons. I'm going to repeat the process with exempt and non-exempt. I'm going to add new field, select radio button, and position it and click. The first one will be named exempt. And the group name is different. It's not part of this type of position, so I'm going to select it, rename it exempt, non-exempt. And then I'll add my second button. Group name is correct, and I'll change this to non-exempt. These aren't aligned very well. There are some shortcuts for straightening alignment. If you select both of them, hold down the control key, and you can select more than one box at a time. Right mouse click on one of the boxes, and you have the option to align. And I'm going to choose align left. Now if I select outside, you'll see that they're better aligned. Now I'll add radio buttons for Can This Employer Be Contacted? Add new field, radio button. And this is not part of the exempt, non-exempt group names, so I'm going to change this to Employer Contact. And this first one will be yes. And then I'll add another button. And this one will be no. And those are all I need. And again, they're a little misaligned. So if I click here and then click on the control key and click on this, I select both of them. Right mouse click inside one of them, choose align distributor center. And this time I'm going to choose align top. If I click outside, you can see that they're better aligned. I've also noticed up top that this form field seems to be corresponding to the title, and I'd actually like it to say name. So I'm going to right mouse click inside of it, and I'm going to choose rename field. Then I'll click outside. As I scroll through it, everything looks good so far, but the proof is in the pudding, as they say. So I'm going to close out of editing and actually try to type and see if everything looks good. Wow. Text looks pretty big. So it looks like I'm going to have to go in and adjust my font size. I'll need to go back to Edit. And it seems that I've got various font sizes here. So what I'm going to need to do is select all of my form fields and then pick a uniform size for them. The easiest way to do that is to view the entire page on the screen. So I've clicked on that button and position my mouse slightly outside the fields and draw a box around them. They're all highlighted now, and I can click inside any one of these form fields, right mouse click, and I'll go to Properties. Under Appearance, the font size varies, and I'd like to make it be 8 points uniformly, so I'm going to click on 8 and then close. If I exit form editing and I zoom in a little, you can see that my fields now all are 8 points. Let me try typing down in here. I'll just type some nonsense text. That looks good. I'm allowed to type multiple lines in this field. If I click down here, however, I'm not able to press enter. Looks like I'm going to have to format that, and the same seems to be true of skills. I can't seem to press enter and pull up another line. So I'm going to have to make adjustments to these three fields. I'm going to go over here to Edit, and I'm going to scroll down a bit, and using the Control key, pressing that, I'm going to select all three of these. And then I can right mouse click, and again I'm going to go to Properties. And in this case, we're going to go over to Options, and I need to select multi-line. When I do that, you'll notice the text now jumps up to the top. And if I close form editing, you'll see that I am able to create second, third, and fourth lines. And that's what I want. Same here. Taking a last look at everything, I think everything is good. Great. Now what I'm going to do before saving it is clear out all the sample text I've put in. So I'm going to go to More Form Options and select Clear Form. And at this point I'm going to save the file. It looks good to go, so I'm going to select Save, Employment History Log Form, and I'll press the Save button. And now I can email it to people or post it online. We're done with this file, so I'll go to File on the menu bar and choose Exit. Thank you for watching this series of tutorials. Good luck!